All right, so back to it. Now, we ended the last lecture talking about how the missing piece of this story is cultural group selection. Why is it so important? Well, the social learning mechanisms that we talked about last week can explain why once certain religious ideas become popular, they can reach fixation, that is, they can become nearly universal within a group. And the reason for that is because things like the conformity bias and social norms are going to create a positive feedback loop, such that when it starts being a majority who has them, it starts being increasingly uncomfortable for the minority who doesn't hold it. There's going to be increasing pressure for them to hold the beliefs of the majority of the group, and there's going to be increased deterrence not to be different from the rest of the group. And so you can see how the religious ideas that pop up from the, as we talked about, the genetic evolutionary bedrock of the mind as byproducts of our default cognition are going to lead to certain religious ideas which are then going to pervade the group. And so we see how the products of the mind become pervasive cultural ideas. However, there's a mystery, which is that the religious ideas that you see in small-scale societies, both historical ones and the ones that exist today, systematically differ from the religious ideas that you see in the big world religions that dominate most of the world now, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, etc. Why is that? If religious ideas are the natural and inevitable consequence of the human mind, a human mind that, of course, has stayed genetically, evolutionarily the same for the last 100,000, 200,000 years, then why have the ideas changed? To explain that, we need to look at what happens between groups. So this is where we get finally to the idea of cultural group selection. So just as some ideas can win out over others, can be selected over others, that's cultural evolution. Whole groups can as well. And when they do so, they bring their ideas with them. Those ideas thrive along with the group, and the ideas that are attached to the losing groups, they take their culture with them to be put on the trash heap of cultural history, to extinction. So how are some groups selected for over others? Here are five mechanisms for cultural group selection. So the first is probably the most obvious one, direct intergroup competition. In war, in direct conflict, one group triumphs over another group and vanquishes it. The winning group takes over. Their ideas win. So one example of that is, so anything that makes your military or war effort stronger is something which could be culturally selected for. Those groups that stumbled upon ideas that maybe made their soldiers more bonded together, more devoted to the group, or more otherwise physically formidable, would have been the groups that outcompeted the other ones. And as a result, those ideas that contributed to their success would start to take over the world. One example of this is seen in the types of military drills that soldiers have been doing for ages, which is, for instance, marching in lockstep with each other. This type of synchronous behavior, when you move or sing in a consistent lockstep pattern with other members of your group, seems to be particularly effective at bonding you with the group, allowing you to pursue pro-social ends together, and when it comes to it, potentially die for the group. And so, because that's been such a successful cultural idea, it has been selected for and pervades militaries today. Other ideas we talked about are the use of fictive kin labels with your military platoons. So calling your brothers in arms, thinking about them in terms of that kin psychology activates the kin psychology mechanisms, making you more willing to actually die for them, and as a result, making your military more effective. You can have also differential group survival without conflict. Groups don't even have to meet each other. If one group can out-survive the other, say because there's a harsh environment, say they're more resilient to floods or terrible winters, or have more resilient farming techniques that prevent starvation in the case of drought, those groups will outsurvive the other groups. And as a result, their farming techniques or their clothing technology will be the ones that get passed down. Differential reproduction. This is another obvious one, right? So if your group has more children, then, well, because children tend to have the same norms as their parents, those ideas pervade more. Moreover, there's indirect benefits. The more children you have, the more people in your group, the more successful you're going to be in, say, intergroup competition, and the more successful you're going to be in terms of differential group survival without conflict. As we talked about before, bigger population sizes allow for more cultural innovation, which allows you to exploit and survive your environment better. So what that means is that any type of cultural idea, which all else being equal, encourages people to have more children, increasing fertility rates or decreasing death rates is going to be something which is culturally selected for. Differential migration. So if you have two groups, one of them is doing better. One of them has, say, more food or more attractive cultural norms. You can siphon off people from the other group. People might leave as refugees from the other group and join your group, thereby increasing your group size, depleting the other group size, increasing the pervasiveness of your norms, since you have now more people to hold the norms, and again, offer you the indirect advantages through direct intergroup competition or through differential group survival. And finally, prestige and success-based group transmission. Now, this one doesn't involve changes in the numbers of people, either one group vanquishing another, taking their members, out-reproducing them. Instead, this can involve just the transfer of cultural ideas, whereas the number of people can stay the same. So members of a less prestigious or successful group can look enviously at a more successful and more prestigious group and adopt their cultural ideas in the same way that you would do so by imitating a high status individual. And we've seen this happen repeatedly throughout history. Recent examples are in the late 19th and early 20th century, Eastern cultures emulating more economically successful Western cultures. So Japan, when it was entering its attempts to become a world power in the late 19th century, looked at who was the most successful world power at the time then, the US, a fading Britain, and decided to adopt Western industrialization techniques. But also, because in prestige bias, you don't know exactly what it is to imitate, they also adopted a raft of other characteristics of the culture, including the dress. Another rather extreme example is what Mustafa Atatürk did in Turkey following World War I. Prior to World War I, Turkey was part of a larger Ottoman Empire, which met its end in the war. Atatürk, who was a war hero, used the influence and prestige he had over his group to dramatically modernize and westernize Turkish culture, adopting the Western alphabet, adopting Western legal codes, political structures, as well as dress. Eventually, he made the fez, you know, the Arabic, I'll put a picture of it on the screen, he banned it altogether. And that actually defined Turkey for the better part of the 20th century, only seeing quite a manifest rejection of that in recent years. So how does this relate to religion? Well, you could probably see a bunch of examples already about how certain aspects of religion embody these transmission mechanisms. But let's talk about three in particular: fertility, monogamy, and morality. Starting with fertility. So imagine you had two religions, and one of them had cultural norms about sex being evil. The founder of the religion really didn't like it and banned it throughout. So nobody was allowed to have sex. Nobody had children. The only way that they managed to spread their religion was through recruiting other members with the promise that you'll never have sex if you join my religion. The second religion, on the other hand, not only does it encourage sex, but it discourages any type of sex which wouldn't result in reproduction. Gays are out, birth control is out, abortion is out, and there's direct encouragement to have as many children as possible. Which religion is going to last longer? Well, these are two real examples. So the first example is the Shakers, which was an American religion that emerged, I think, in the 1800s. Similarly, Mormonism, also a recent American religion, but with very different norms about fertility. Now, this operates on the cultural group selection mechanism of differential reproductive advantage, obviously. Religions that most encouraged behaviors that increased fertility gave their cultures an evolutionary edge and thus were more likely to survive, as were the cultures that they were attached to. This term family values we don't actually talk about too much anymore, but even just 15 years ago, it would be talked about a lot in the context of US politics, and it was code for basically social conservatism. Traditional norms of heterosexual marriage, of having kids, of no abortion, etc. Those are basically just values that contribute to having large families. And if you look within the US, broken down by religion, you can see how the fertility rates differ between, say, the religiously unaffiliated, where every one woman has 1.7 children, which is below replacement rate, which would be 2.1. It's below what the average Christian woman has, below what the average Muslim woman has, and below what, yes, the average Mormon woman has. Now, if you don't think these numbers look very different, let's do the math on what happens to 50 religiously unaffiliated people and 50 Mormons after several generations. So they both start out at 50. Five generations later, you've got 22 religiously unaffiliated people, and your number of Mormons is approaching 800. And so you can see the impact on group survival that these reproductive advantages actually has. If you look today at the Shakers and the Mormons, they still exist, but in different numbers. For the Mormons, there are now 6.5 million of them. For the Shakers, there are 4 living somewhere in southern Maine. That's the impact of differential reproductive advantage. That's why those religions that manage to increase fertility, that manage to sacralize these family values, are the ones that we now see today. Those ideas have inherited the earth. All right, let's now talk about monogamy, which is something we've talked about before, right? So as we talked about before, we are not naturally genetically evolved for monogamy. It is not our default state. And as a result, if you look at the ethnographic record, if you look at most societies across history, monogamy is actually the rarity, not the norm. It's not the majority. Actually, only about 18% seem to have strongly enforced monogamy rules. But what is natural, as we've talked about many times, doesn't necessarily mean it's good. And it doesn't even necessarily mean it's culturally adaptive. Polygamous societies have problems. I think we've talked about it before, but let's just make it super clear. So imagine that you have a society of this many people, and one man is a particularly high status man, has particular power in the group, and there are no monogamy norms to stop him from doing this. So he's living the Richard Branson or Dan Bilzerian life. Now, even if the rest of the women are monogamous and you have a good chunk of the population which is one-on-one monogamously paired, you have this excess number of unpaired men. And as we talked about, there's nothing in the world that's more dangerous to themselves or others than unpaired men. What you find is that being at the bottom of a hierarchy, especially a reproductive hierarchy, a sexual hierarchy, increases risky behavior. Unmarried men are more likely to murder, rob, rape, gamble, abuse drugs, and all this is true even after you statistically control for socioeconomic status or age or ethnicity. Being married halves your odds of committing a violent crime. And if you look at societies that have fewer unpaired men, they tend to have lower crime rates, but also higher levels of GDP per capita. They tend to be richer societies. As a result, societies that somehow manage to enforce monogamy are more stable, more cooperative, and wealthy, and thus could outcompete those other societies where you had all these men fighting each other and destabilizing the society. But how do you do that? How do you enforce the cultural norms that favor the people on the bottom when they disfavor the most powerful people in the society, who are the ones who typically are making the rules? Well, you put something above those people. So those societies that manage to convince somehow those high status males to adopt relatively more monogamous ways ended up being more successful. And religion moralized and sacralized, made sacred monogamy, turning it into not just a cost-benefit analysis, but a divine rule, something which had to be followed, lest you violate this entire other edifice that it's connected to, including your identity and your esteem in the eyes of others. So that becomes something even that these high-status men at the top, the Richard Bransons and Dan Bilzerians, have to actually follow. And those are your monogamous marriage norms. And so what's critical about this is understanding the power of cultural evolution and cultural group selection here. Because those men who stood to most genetically benefit from non-monogamy were actually having their genetic interests curtailed by this cultural force. Worse for them as individuals, worse for their genes, but better for the group. That's something that really struggles to be stabilized at the genetic level, but it's something that's readily achieved by cultural group selection. All right, finally, morality. So I don't know if you guys remember E.O. Wilson. We talked about him during our morality and cooperation lecture. He's the entomologist at Harvard who founded the field of sociobiology, the progenitor to evolutionary psychology. Now, he's got this famous quote, which is, "Selfishness beats altruism within groups, but altruistic groups beat selfish groups." It seems like a paradox, but it's not really, and I'll explain why. So we, in that morality lecture, as well as in our intelligence lecture, talked about how 150 or 147.8, Dunbar's number, the upper limit at which the genetic adaptations for cooperation allow a group to be stable. You can know 150 people well, and as a result, everybody knows each other in those societies. Nobody's really anonymous from anybody else, and so cooperation is able to be stabilized. On the other hand, if you go beyond that, what happens? Well, now people have a difficult time keeping track of others. There are strangers in the group. There are anonymous people in the group, which means that it leads to an environment in which selfish people can exploit others. People are able to act non-cooperatively, to free ride on all the other cooperators without being detected and punished. And because that is an adaptive strategy, it spreads and eventually it overcomes the entire group. At which point it can't survive at the level of 400 people. You can't have 400 people not cooperating together. And so the group fissions into smaller groups, smaller than 150. But as we talked about when we talked about the mechanisms of cultural group selection, bigger groups beat smaller groups. They're able to outcompete them in direct conflict. They're able to outsurvive them for many reasons. So if you somehow managed to get a group that was bigger than these, well, that group would be able to take over all of them, would be able to beat all of them. And since higher levels of cooperation are what would allow those groups to grow larger, cultural group selection would favor anything that was able to increase cooperation beyond those genetic limits. So the challenge then becomes, how do you stop people from reverting back to selfishness when they can get away with it, when it would be in their genetic interests to do so, when they would be able to free ride, extracting all the cooperation from other people, but contributing nothing themselves? That would be a genetically adaptive strategy. That's the thing which leads groups larger than 150 to fission, absent some sort of cultural mechanism that allows groups to stabilize larger amounts of cooperation. And so you see where I'm going here. That's what the podcast was about. So I won't belabor the supernatural punishment argument that I made in the podcast, but the point that I want to stress across all three of these is that when we talk about the religions we see today, those are not representative of the religious cognitive defaults we have in our head. Monogamous marriage, which is now a key aspect of many world religions, is not our genetic default. It is something which has been culturally selected. The pronatalist norms are also not inevitable defaults. Now, this is overstating the case a bit. It's not as if we are naturally born shakers, anything but. However, we have, from the moment we discovered the connection between sex and reproduction, have tried to suppress it. Having kids is great. Having a lot of kids is a pain in the ass. And so, for as long as we've known about that connection, we've been looking for forms of birth control. Certain ideas about religion were culturally selected to stop us from doing that, because it's in our cultural group interests to have more kids than we actually otherwise would want to. And then finally, the big morally concerned punitive gods that I talked about in the podcast are also not our cognitive defaults. The gods that we saw in historical societies tended to be small trickster gods who were rather unconcerned about human moral affairs and weren't all that powerful either. They've scaled up over time because the big god, the big omniscient, punitive, omnipotent god, is the one that actually was selected for because of the benefits that it offered the group. And so today, to understand religion, we have to understand that they were shaped not just by genetic evolution, but by cultural evolution, and in particular, cultural evolution that was targeted at the level of selection of the group, not the individual. And what that means is that to understand religion, it's not enough to understand genetic evolution like Darwin did. We have to understand cultural evolution and cultural group selection, like you guys now do. Now, there's one big question that remains, and that's, what is the future of religion? What is the future of religion, given what we understand now about these cultural, evolutionary, and cultural group selective processes? One of the arguments I made in the podcast, if you remember, is that religions have served this important social function, but now there are secular alternatives, which might be as good, if not better. This is something that my colleague Aaron Oren Zion has called climbing the ladder and then kicking it. The argument being that the less religious societies are able today to be less religious because of the benefits they previously wrought from religion, but now they've outlived those. They used religion to scale up the ladder to the level of cooperation and size and wealth that they have now, but now, given these centralized secular institutions, no longer have as much need for what religion offers to the culture. And indeed, if you look across countries at the level, the strength of the rule of law, the strength of those secular institutions, and you plot that against how important religion is to the people, you see a pretty tight relationship where those places, Netherlands, Denmark, Australia, Canada, that have strong secular institutions of law, that people have faith in those institutions, they don't need religious faith as much. And the general trend is that countries move towards this. Countries move in the direction of stronger, more reliable rule of law. This happens in fits and starts, and over the last several years, we've seen some fits, but the general trend is towards more stable secular institutions, and presumably, thus, away from religion. But what about demography? What about differential reproductive advantage? We saw those numbers of fertility rates among women in the US, of religiously unaffiliated women, all the way up to Mormons. The most religious people within societies tend to have the most children. Moreover, the most religious societies are also the ones that have most children. In fact, in the least religious places in the world, you tend to see something approaching negative fertility rates, below replacement rate fertility. Now, yes, they have immigration, they have differential migration, but the bulk of the population growth in the world is happening in the more religious places. And since parents tend to pass down their norms to their children, it's likely, all the projections suggest, that we're going to see an increase in not only the number, but the proportion of religious people in the future. So you have these different cultural trends going against each other. How is this going to end up? Well, we don't know yet, but it's something that might become clear within your lifetimes. All right, that's it for this lecture. Next week, we put all the pieces together and use it to understand why our entire civilization has turned out the way it has. A Christian, Christian said.